Good afternoon, everyone, and a warm welcome. My lords, members of the House of Commons, distinguished guests, welcome to the Queen's Robing Room and to the second in the Lord Speaker's Global Lecture Series. It's a pleasure and a privilege and an honour to welcome the 39th President of the United States, Jimmy Carter, to Parliament. After leaving office, many US presidents have retired from public life, and few have had much impact on the national or international stage. One, John Quincy Adams, declared on the eve of leaving the White House in 1829, "There is nothing more pathetic in life than a former president." President Carter, however, has gone against the grain. In his farewell address in 1981, he vowed to work as a citizen, as he had as president, for the values upon which the United States was founded. His characteristic dogged determination, his commitment to the promotion of human rights and the alleviation of human suffering through the Carter Center, his tireless diplomatic work on the international stage, and his backbreaking endeavors with Habitat for Humanity have all borne out this vow. And in fact, backbreaking is a very appropriate term, because I just heard from President Carter that he himself spends a week a year actually building houses. So there's a lesson for us to learn. With a rare energy that so few possess, President Carter has achieved more in his retirement than most of us will manage in our lifetimes. He's accomplished as much since stepping down from the presidency as he did before assuming that great office of state. And perhaps his most impressive achievement since leaving the White House has been his pivotal role in eradicating Guinea worm disease. The first disease likely to be eradicated by man without vaccine or curative medicine, and likely only the second after smallpox to be eradicated at all through man-made efforts. Surely even President John Quincy Adams would have been heartened by that. Let me now, dear people, give the floor to our distinguished guest, who will be speaking for about 30 minutes. And following his speech, we'll take a few questions from the audience and perhaps one or two also from Twitter, as this event is being webcast live. I'm delighted to introduce to you President Jimmy Carter.
Thank you. Well, I want to thank, first of all, Lord Speaker, Baroness D'Souza. I want to thank the members of Commons who are here, the members of the House of Lords, and also guests and my personal friends who are scattered throughout the audience. And I'm very grateful for this invitation to come and speak to you this afternoon. As a matter of fact, this proves that there are at least sometimes when having been president can be an advantage. Thank you for that. I remember that soon after I left the White House, I went to China for an extended visit and came back through Japan. And I was asked to speak at a small college in the southern part of Japan and at the graduation speech. And since I was just newly out of the White House and this was a very small college, I noticed that the audience was very nervous. The students, their parents, the professors were all kind of uptight. And I decided to put them at ease by telling them maybe a funny story. But I knew that it took a long time to translate English into Japanese. So instead of using my funniest joke, I used my shortest joke. And when it was over, the audience erupted into laughter. In fact, it was the best response I've ever had to telling a funny story. And I couldn't wait to get to the end of my speech so I could ask the interpreter, "How did you tell my joke?" And the interpreter was very evasive. But I persisted, and finally he ducked his head and he said, "I told the audience, President Carter told a funny story, everyone must laugh." Well, as you know, we are two friendly nations. Some people say we're separated by a common language, but I don't think I need an interpreter this afternoon. There is an exhibit called Countdown to Zero, Defeating Disease, at the American Museum of Natural History in New York. It was prepared by the Museum of Natural History and the Carter Center, and it's been quite popular. It was originally scheduled to be there for just 6 months, but they've extended it now to 2 full years, so it'll be at the end of 2017. And tomorrow, an updated exhibit of the same kind will be opening at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine, and will be in London for at least 3 months. And we hope that all of you will have time to go by and visit and get a little bit more than you'll get from my speech this afternoon. It's fitting to bring this exhibit to this great country because you've made so much progress in improving global health. Your two prestigious tropical medical schools, the London School, which I've already mentioned, and the Liverpool School of Tropical Medicine also have partnered with the Carter Center for more than 2 decades. Supporting our efforts to eradicate disease, advance peace, and to build hope. Drastically reducing or wiping out our diseases from entire regions or even the whole world is not an easy task, but it's clearly possible to do so, and that's been proven. There are very practical reasons for alleviating the suffering of people in other countries, because first of all, it keeps the disease from affecting ourselves and those we love. It advances science and technology. It supports commerce and economic development, and it's also very efficient. These are all good practical reasons. And it's also the right thing to do, to share our knowledge, experience, and science with those who need our help to improve their own lives. It's also an act of kindness, a recognition of our common humanity. These are ambitious goals, and many people must come together to accomplish them, including our NGO and others like us, your government and others as well. Private foundations and national ministries of health are also central partners in this fight against neglected tropical diseases. That's the name that they bear from the World Health Organization. This year, to combat lymphatic filariasis, schistosomiasis, trachoma, river blindness, guinea worm, and others, our Carter Center goal is to administer 81 million treatments. You may know this is more than the people that live in the United Kingdom, and it's a very great challenge for us. We're helped by many other people, GlaxoSmithKline, the Lions International, Merck, Leventis, and others who are represented here this afternoon. Neglected tropical diseases all need greater attention because they have such a devastating impact, not only on the lives of the poor. These diseases are no longer known in even moderately wealthy countries, like China and say, Egypt no longer have these kind of diseases, just in the homes of the poorest people of all. And these diseases are neglected because the people who live in those countries are neglected. They all need greater attention because they have such a devastating impact. We've learned from personal experience that poor people, the poorest of all people who are often scorned or derogated, are just as intelligent as we are. They're just as ambitious as we. They are just as hardworking as we. Their family values are just as good as ours. They just need some help, and that's what we provide through the Carter Center in this program that I'm describing. I've come to admire their judgment and wisdom, their courage and faith, and their great accomplishments when given a chance to use their innate abilities in improving their own lives. Rosalynn and I founded the Carter Center in 1982, initially to focus on peace and conflict resolution. And then in the early years, we recruited Dr. Bill Fagey, who was the head of Centers for Disease Control before we recruited him, and who had been instrumental, he was a leader in the eradication of smallpox, which was done finally in 1977 is when we had our last case of smallpox in the world. That happens to be when I was president of the United States. Knowing that eradication was possible by looking at the example with smallpox, in 1986, we decided to go after a particularly difficult and unpleasant one called dracunculiasis, or guinea worm disease. Dr. Donald Hopkins, who who was also at CDC and was also part of the eradication of smallpox, joined the Carter Center to devise and to implement strategies to eradicate the worm. As a former president, I used my influence to gather resources to raise money, to publicize the effort, and then to go to every country involved and induce the leaders of the country to let their ministers of health cooperate with us. In 1986, we surveyed the world, and we found 3.5 million cases of guinea worm in 21 countries in Asia and in Africa, three countries in Asia and the rest of the countries in sub-Saharan Africa. Last year, we only had 22 cases in 20 villages in the entire world. So this debilitating disease is on the brink of eradication. The parasite life cycle is this. People in isolated communities that have no access to running water in a stream or even a deep well must get their drinking water from stagnant rain ponds that fill up during the rainy season and then remain stagnant or dormant for the other 9 months or so of the year. And it's within those stagnant waters that the guinea worm larva breed. When a person with an emerging worm enters the pond to get more water or to ease the pain of their affliction, the worm ejects hundreds of thousands of larvae into the water again, which are then eaten by tiny water fleas, so-called. When people drink the contaminated water, the larvae end up in their abdomens. And then they stay there and eventually grow into a longer worm and eventually, sometimes as long as a meter. That's the average length of a guinea worm. The worm emerges by releasing an acid-like substance that helps him to burn the inside of his skin or epidermis, and then they begin to emerge. And it takes about 30 days on the average for a guinea worm to emerge from a body with excruciating pain. This is an intense burning sensation. In the Bible, by the way, this disease is called the fiery serpent. It afflicted the Israelites leaving from Egypt under slavery and going through a desert area for 40 years to enter the promised land. And this, it was called the fiery serpent that afflicted them. The ancient treatment for guinea worm is just wrapping it around a stick about as big as my finger or so. And instead of emerging in 30 days, you can expedite the exit of the guinea worm with being careful not to break it, so it comes out in about 20 days. That was the only treatment for thousands of years of guinea worm before, you might say, the Carter Center came along. You can make that down to about two or three weeks if you're lucky. It's believed that this inspired the symbol for medicine. A lot of people think that it's a snake that's kind of wrapped around a rod. It's actually a guinea worm wrapped around a stick. And this is a staff of Asclepius, which is now the basic symbol for medicine itself. So it's an ancient disease and a symbol for the entire medical profession, the treatment of guinea worm. There's no vaccine and no medical cure for guinea worm disease once it starts. It's being conquered mainly by health education to keep people from entering water sources when they have a guinea worm emerging from their body, and also from filtering their water in their contaminated pond through a very fine filter cloth so that everybody can drink the water that doesn't have the guinea worm egg in it. At times, we also use a mild larvicide called abate, which is given to us by BASF to kill the water fleas and also the larva in the water. Guinea worm has a one-year cycle. If we can filter every drink and keep the people out of the water when they have an emerging worm, then the disease transmission in that village stops forever. The Guinea Worm campaign has accomplished this now, our campaign, in 23,700 villages in the world. We have guinea worm now only in 20 villages on Earth. Some of you may have seen a guinea worm emerge because it's been quite prevalent in past years. But the first time I saw guinea worm was in a small village of about 500 people, just about 50 miles from Accra, the capital of Ghana. We went into this village, which had about 300 people almost, that had guinea worm emerging from their bodies. And we were in a clearing in the jungle. And over at the edge of the crowd during the ceremonies, when we were explaining our project to the people there in the village, I saw a pretty young woman standing there holding her baby in her right arm. And I decided after the speeches were over to go over and just speak to her and ask her the name of the baby. When I got over there, I realized finally that it was not a baby she was holding in her arm, but her right breast, which was about more than a foot long, and it had a guinea worm emerging from the nipple of her breast. Later that year, she had 11 other guinea worms emerging from different places in her body. This was a horrible, made a horrible impact on all of us who were there. We had a very wealthy Pakistani banker there with us, and he volunteered to give all the money and personnel needed to dig that village a deep well so they no longer had to use their contaminated pond. And we came back a year later, zero guinea worm. That was my first experience with the actual eradication of guinea worm. We had, I would say, our biggest problem at the beginning was communicating with people who spoke, even a village 5 miles away spoke a different dialect. And so the people had hundreds of dialects in almost every country in Africa where guinea worm existed. And so that was a very difficult problem. They had no television at that time and very few radios either. And there was practically zero illiteracy. The average man in those villages, there were 3% of the men who were literate, and practically no women had ever been educated to read or to write. So you see, it was almost impossible just to communicate with the people there about what was going on. So we decided to finally to use cartoons. And so we would draw two cartoons. One was a woman over here who dipped water out of a pond, and she filtered her water, and then the bottom picture showed that she didn't have any guinea worm. The other woman in the cartoon didn't filter her water, and she had guinea worms coming out of her body. And that was the only way we could communicate with the people and teach them how to do it. And the women adopted those cartoons quite eagerly. They replicated the cartoons that we gave them and printed them on cloth and made dresses and shirts, the clothing out of the guinea worm cartoons. So they were used as decorations. But that was not an automatic solution. We had a lot of the Peace Corps volunteers from the United States helping us with the guinea worm program. And in Niger, a young Peace Corps volunteer drew the cartoons. Two women were standing in the water. One did the right thing and didn't have guinea worm eggs, and the other one did the wrong thing and she had guinea worm. But the people went into an uproar. They said they would rather have guinea worm than no feet. They had never seen a cartoon or a picture with people without any feet. Well, the most worms we ever recorded from a human being, you might be interested in knowing, was 84 emerging from a farmer in Nigeria. That was in 1999. Nigeria had the most cases of guinea worm of any country in the world, 656,000 cases of guinea worm. And they were one of the earliest countries to have zero guinea worm. This Nigerian farmer, though, he was treated by our people. The guinea worms were gotten out of him and the wounds were treated. And then since he had survived and he knew all about the guinea worm cycle at that time, he volunteered his services to teach people in surrounding villages about how to avoid the experience. We have a large coalition of partners, including DuPont Chemical Company. I went to see the chairman of DuPont Company, and I asked him for $50,000 a year to do a guinea worm. He said, well, how do you address it? So he brought my response to the board of directors of DuPont, and they devised a special fiber that would not rot in the tropics. If you take an average napkin off a table, like we had at lunch, and you get it wet and dry 5 or 6 or 10 times a day, it'll be rotted in a couple of weeks. But they developed a special fiber that would not rot, and they created about 6 million square meters of filter cloth, gave them to us, and that's how we basically got rid of the guinea worm. The Tuaregs, you might know that they're the nomads in the Sahara Desert, in the northern part of Mali and Niger and so forth, and they had a multiple drinking holes because they would just stay on their camels or their horses and ride from one place to another, and they couldn't have a big filter cloth to go over a jar of water because they didn't use jars or filter cloths, so they developed a very fine pipe filter that they could wear around their neck. It was just a reed the point it's fished out, and then on the end of it was tied a little tiny filter cloth around it like this. And so we used that, and later Vestergaard, a Danish company, worked with our center to create more than 9 million pipe filters. And when we faced guinea worm in southern Sudan, where war was still going on and we couldn't get our people in there, we sent in about 9 million of these filter cloths that people wore around the neck. And John Garang, who was a leader of the revolutionary forces in South Sudan, every time I saw him, he made sure he had his pipe filter on his neck to set an example. And I wore a pipe filter too while I was there. I think you'll get a sample of those maybe today. But when we finally got into South Sudan, they had a much lower incidence of guinea worm than we had anticipated because they had been wearing the pipe filters and using them. So the Tuaregs themselves invented one of our key weapons in the use of against guinea worm. You might be interested in knowing that the total cost of our program for the last 29 years now has been about 225 million pounds, a tremendous bargain, by the way, because we have averted more than 80 million cases of guinea worm since 1986. To put it into perspective, the total cost that I just described, 225 million pounds, is less than the cost of one C-17 aircraft. And the United States has 190 of those, most of them never used. So that puts it into perspective. We conduct an intense search for remaining cases in every country where we have made progress. And when there are finally zero cases in a country, the World Health Organization requires at least 3 more years of intense surveillance of that country all over to make sure that no new cases of guinea worm are found. And they or we sometimes give as high a reward as $200, which is enormous money for them if they report any case of guinea worm. So we make sure this is completely eliminated. And of course, the Carter Center works with these countries to the end. We now have 198 countries on Earth that have gone through this process of having zero cases of guinea worm and then going through the 3-year examination process. We've had some unexpected developments during this last 30 years. Eradication program. The greatest remaining challenges are from insecurity in parts of Mali and South Sudan and Ethiopia. The only other country is Chad. But we still have civil wars in some of those countries, and it makes it impossible almost for us to get filter cloths or workers to go in and help eliminate the disease. And this is a very serious problem. Also, we have found guinea worm recently in some dogs on one river in Chad. So those are the major obstacles. We have found dogs with guinea worm in 5 other countries that we treated, but every time we've gotten rid of them in human beings, they disappeared in dogs as well. So we have good prospects there. In the last week, by the way, we've had 4 security instances among the about 10,000 people that work for us on guinea worm, and with one death, unfortunately, in South Sudan. Despite these challenges, though, both in Mali, where war is going on, as you know, in South Sudan, last year, between 2014 and 2015, both of them reduced their incidence of guinea worm by 85%. So they made very good progress, even in spite of the war, because the governments who want to get rid of this disease put them at a very high priority. In Chad, during the annual fish harvest, dogs have been eating raw fish or fish entrails, carrying guinea worm larvae. And we offer a small stipend for everybody that has a dog that has a guinea worm if they'll tie the dog up and throughout the time until the guinea worm emerges. So we're making good progress in Chad as well. By the way, to change the subject to some degree now away from guinea worm, there are other potential disease candidates for eradication, and we're looking closely at these. The only international task force on Earth that does this is located at the Carter Center. It's financed by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And we assemble groups of people, a representative from Great Britain is always there, by the way, from the Liverpool School of Tropical Health. And they come to the Carter Center, and we analyze every human illness to ascertain which one might possibly be completely eliminated in a particular country or region or eradicated from the entire world. So this group does this, and we now are working, the Carter Center is now working on, we found 8 diseases in all. We're working on most of them, but but you might be interested in knowing that the Guinea worm, first of all, dracunculiasis, poliomyelitis, polio is well known, mumps, rubella, lymphatic filariasis, which is elephantiasis. This causes enormous swelling of genital organs and arms and legs. And cysticercosis, measles, and yaws. These are fairly well known to many people expert on tropical diseases. Two of these diseases only, just two out of the eight, have been selected by the World Health Organization to be targets for eradication, and that's polio and guinea worm. And of course, the finish line is in sight for both of them. The guinea worm campaign has taught us that there's a great deal of potential and benefit from eradicating diseases or eliminating them from large regions of the world. In fact, the Carter Center is already working on some of these. Personally, we try to eliminate vertebral blindness. We've done this in almost completely now in South America, in our hemisphere, and we're working on eradicating or eliminating this disease from Uganda. We've just about succeeded there, and we've tried it in North Sudan, where vertebral blindness is much more virulent than it is in our hemisphere, because it was brought over to our hemisphere by slaves during a century or more ago. And so we've proven, though, that what we've already done successfully in South American area can be done in Africa. We're also working to get rid of, we're also working on blinding trachoma, and also we're trying to work now to eradicate two diseases from Hispaniola, which is Haiti and the Dominican Republic, and that's malaria and lymphatic filariasis. In our hemisphere, both these diseases are carried by the same mosquito. In Africa, they are carried by two different mosquitoes. We lead a coalition that has eliminated vertebral blindness in six countries in our hemisphere, and the only exception there is a very small tribe of Yanomami Indians that live on the riverbank bordering on the border between Venezuela and Brazil. These Indians, which is a very small tribe, only 25,000 or so in all, they don't know where the border is, and they travel freely back and forth the border. But recently, these two countries have agreed to a compact, which has been very difficult politically to achieve, to let us go back and forth across the border without getting a visa every time we went. So we'll be able to finish the job, I believe, now. I'd like to close my remarks this afternoon by sharing with you some common lessons and principles we've learned that can be applied to disease eradication, that's the whole world, elimination, which is from one country or one region, or just control efforts, which is year after year. First, we build trust, I might say, in us, among the affected people, by approaching them with complete respect and recognizing their independence and freedom and their knowledge of their own communities, much greater than our knowledge of their communities. We don't impose our ideas on them, but help them solve their own problems, and guinea worm obviously is recognized by them as a serious problem. Every step is a collaboration between us and them, and we give them all the credit for success. The Carter Center doesn't claim any success in a village. It's the village chiefs and the ones who did the work, volunteers. And in a country when it completely has gotten rid of the last case of guinea worm, we let the president of that country announce the success, or the Minister of Health, and not the Carter Center. The ultimate decisions are made completely within the local communities, and they've been, as I said earlier, over 23,700 of them in different countries. Our overall strategy is set by us and the Minister of Health with his approval, but the actual work is now taking place through about 10,000 volunteers who have to monitor every village on earth that might have another outbreak of guinea worm. And this is about almost 5,000 communities. So even though we're just about on the verge of getting rid of guinea worm, we still have to monitor every village, so if somebody does get guinea worm, we isolate that person and prevent them going back in the pond to spread the disease again. So we provide the knowledge and supplies, but they provide the responsibility and take the risk. We have a variety of partners involved with us, civic organizations and local churches and mosques in particular. Before we get to a village in the past, quite often it's been the local imam or the local missionary who has taken care of wrapping this worm around a stick to make sure that it emerges frequently. So they still did a lot of the health work. there has to be exact, I say, quantifiable results. So we know in every village, in every country, exactly how many guinea worms still exist in that country each year. So we can let the people know that there has been progress since the last year, or not much progress, and if it's a problem, of course, we help them solve the problem and overcome the difficulty. We have an ethical obligation, I think, to prevent suffering wherever we can, meaning this obligation is very dear to us at the Carter Center, as you know, and we'll carry it on after I'm no longer alive. My prayer has been that I will live longer than the last guinea worm. And so, my doctors tell me, by the way, that I'm making a good response to the treatment I'm getting for the cancer that has appeared in my brain and in my liver. So it's going to be a close race, but I hope still that I'm going to win. Well, if a disease can be eliminated completely from a nation or eradicated from the world, that is much better than just controlling the disease year after year after year interminably, because it's much more cost effective. And when you just control a disease, you don't have the all-out effort for the whole world to get rid of it completely. So that leaves part of the people who suffer from a disease still suffering, which I don't think is very humane and is certainly not cost effective. Our only failure is not to try. And our partnership with your country has been one of the greatest boons that we've had in making this progress that I've already described. As I said in Oslo a few years ago, and I quote myself, the bond of our common humanity is stronger than the divisiveness of our fears and prejudices. I want to thank the Lord Speaker for this opportunity, and Her Majesty the Queen, obviously, for making the space available. Thanks to the House of Commons and the House of Lords, especially Lord Chidji, sitting on the front row, who's been our host and whose daughter, Kate, did a great deal in making the visit here successful and very pleasant for us. But my greatest gratitude is still to the dedicated village volunteers still working tirelessly on the front lines to eliminate this disease completely. Thank you very much.
Come to formal thanks later, but I feel compelled to say my thanks to President Carter for having given us the ingredients for successful development at the end of his talk today. And in particular, I think what he's illustrated is that the eradication of the guinea worm has involved a change in behavior and culture, which is one of the most difficult things to achieve, but obviously one of the most sustainable forms of development. And I suppose the other thing that does also strike me is that if you are willing to remove your name from success, you can achieve great things. I think what we will do now is have questions, and I think there is going to be a roving microphone. What I will do is to just point out 1, 2, 3 people so that the doorkeepers can come to you with a microphone. Could you please say who you are and from whence you come? If you're in the House of Lords, I think we know you, but if you're not in the House of Lords, perhaps you could tell us what organization you come from. So who would, yes, it's James at the back there, James. And then Andrew Mitchell, and then Lord Tree, yes, Ranji. So we've got three. So you can,
yeah. President Carter, good evening. James Landell, BBC. Thank you very much indeed for your lecture, and forgive me for bringing us down to grubby politics. I just wondered if you could give us your assessment of the state of American politics at the moment, particularly the impact of the anti-establishment mood that is clearly existing there, and also whether you are for Sanders or Clinton.
What's the last part?
Sanders or Clinton.
Oh. Well, I was hoping I wouldn't get that question, but I'm not surprised at getting it. Well, I'm not involved directly anymore, but I was the one that put Iowa on the map because when I ran for president, I didn't have any money, and I ran my general election without raising a single penny, and so did my opponent back in those days. But we've had a massive infusion of money into the American political system now. And it's almost impossible for any candidate of a Democratic or Republican Party to be successful without having the ability to raise at least $200 million. Just two people in our country, the Koch brothers, have already announced that they are giving over $800 million to the campaigns this year for president and for U.S. Senate and Congress and the governorships. So that's one of the things that has happened. I think at this moment we've only seen Iowa, and Bernie Sanders was surprising in tying, you know, Hillary Clinton, who was looked upon at the beginning as a unequivocal, inevitable Democratic nominee. And on the other hand, Jeb Bush was looked on with the same degree of confidence as the nominee of the Republican Party. I think he got about 3% in Iowa and is on his way out now. I think the next contest in New Hampshire will be, I think Bernie Sanders will probably carry New Hampshire. He's way ahead in the public opinion polls now. And he's from nearby Vermont, so he has an advantage there, perhaps. And then in my judgment, my estimate is that Trump will prevail in New Hampshire. He's far ahead so far, and I think a direct vote by him will help to overcome the detailed organization that Ted Cruz did that got him the victory, a narrow victory in Iowa. So I don't know what the final result will be. I think my own personal opinion is that it's very likely that Hillary Clinton will still prevail in the Democratic Party. And of course, I'm a Democrat and I'll be supporting the Democratic nominee. Bernie Sanders, though, has had a remarkable showing, particularly among young people. In public opinion polls in Iowa, he had about 85% of support among young people, and Hillary only had about 13%. Among young people, just the reverse of what Obama, just saying that Bernie Sanders had the same advantage in the young people as did Obama in 2008. What's going to happen in the future in the Republican Party, I think, is almost completely unpredictable. I have a feeling that Trump will fade away. You know, when people get ready to actually put on a ballot, this is the person I want to lead me for the next 4 years or 8 years, I think they're going to have a little bit different opinion than they had just looking at the excitement and the issues that come up during the primary season. And I don't know who will be the Republican nominee. Ted Cruz now has the apparent advantage, but he served in the Senate, as you know, and he has zero support among his fellow senators because he has radical beliefs that he's espoused in the Senate, maybe excessively, and he's personally derogated or condemned the integrity of some of his fellow senators. Rubio, the young senator from Florida, I think has a better chance ultimately than Ted Cruz. If I had a choice of Republican nominees, let's just say, for instance, between Cruz and Trump, I think I would choose Trump, which may surprise some of you. But the reason is that Trump has proven already that he's completely malleable. I don't think he has any fixed opinions that he would really go to the White House and fight for. On the other hand, Ted Cruz is not malleable. He has far right-wing policies, in my opinion, that would be pursued aggressively if and when he might become president. So that would be my choice. But I don't yet know, obviously, who either candidate will be. As I said earlier, I'll support either Bernie Sanders or Hillary, whoever gets the nomination. And it'll be one of those. I still believe that Hillary has the best chance. But on the Republican side, I don't really know. In fact, I don't know either side, so.
Maybe we'll get the question on eradication at the scene.
Oh, maybe so.
Dr. Mitchell. Mr. President, I'm not from the BBC, and I'd like to ask you a question about international development. I'm Andrew Mitchell from the House of Commons down the other end.
Yes.
And I used to have responsibility for international development during the first part of the coalition government when I was the Secretary of State for International Development. We work closely with you on NTDs and on particularly on Guinea worm, and we're very proud to use British taxpayers' money to support the yes. fantastic work that you did. The question I want to ask you is this. As you survey the neglected tropical diseases and the other challenges across the piece, particularly in very poor countries, do you see the possibility or the need to change the way in which organizations like the WHO operate? Could we not be more effective internationally through the UN and through other international bodies? In trying to tackle Ebola and the other diseases, which it seems to me we're very slow in doing. Your effort, of course, was with us, was a bilateral effort, and you've done a huge amount across the piece, but it seems to me that the international architecture needs amendment, and I wondered whether you thought that was so.
Well, as you know, WHO is part of the United Nations, and the when we targeted ourselves, guinea worm, to be eradicated, it took us 8 years to get WHO to put guinea worm on the list to be eradicated. And we still only have two diseases, and I mentioned eight diseases total that the Carter Center has now determined can be eradicated. So the bureaucracy of WHO, like all other bureaucracies, is troubling to me. I think it's a dedicated organization, does a lot of wonderful things. I think the Centers for Disease Control, which is right next door to the Carter Center and whom we rely on every day, has learned a lot about the Ebola crisis once it evolved. They were not ready for it. And I think we'll be much more prepared for Ebola the next time it breaks out, and that's probably going to happen in the next 10 or 20 years at the earliest, at the latest. And the more recent disease, obviously, that causes deformed babies, that's caused by mosquito bites, and I don't think that's the kind that we have even considered to be possibly eradicated. As I mentioned in my speech, I think the much more cost-effective way to address these diseases is to target them for elimination in a country or region, or eradicating from the whole world. And we have a lot of them, eight of them now, on our list to be worked on. And my own personal choice for the next disease would probably be river blindness or onchocerciasis, because the Carter Center has proven in the six Latin American countries that we can get rid of it. And we've also confirmed that, as I mentioned, in Uganda and Sudan and other countries in Africa. So that would be a very possible choice. Measles is another choice that could be made, but it has to be officially done by WHO. So we use some of our minimal influence, but it took us 8 years to get approval from WHO, and I haven't put that on the top of my priority list yet to get another one endorsed. But I think that the thing that we should do from a moral point of view and an ethical obligation is to help these people who suffer because they're just ignorant about what causes their problem and how to get rid of it. And it's very inexpensive to eradicate these diseases once you target them and concentrate on them. Even polio, which now has about 70 remaining cases at the end of this past year, it's been, I think, cost-effective. I think nobody would deny that. And we obviously see now the advantage of having done smallpox back even when I was president a long time ago. So to eradicate or eliminate a disease is the best approach, in my opinion, as many as possible. And we need to be more aggressive. I think the governments of the countries, including Great Britain, obviously the United Kingdom, and my government could be very effective in persuading the leaders of WHO, let's be more aggressive in doing this. That's it. One of the messages I want to give today. Thank you for your question.
Lord Tree.
There's another question somewhere.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. I'm Sandy Trees. I'm a crossbench peer here in the House of Lords. And thank you for a lovely talk and all the wonderful work you're doing and the Carter Center are doing for the control of neglected tropical diseases. Mm-hmm. I'd like to ask you about the funding of the control.
Yes.
The funding is coming principally from great philanthropic foundations such as your own, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and so on, two national governments, the United Kingdom and the US governments, just two governments. And as you are well aware, there is a funding gap for us to really push forward and confirm the great gains that have been made in the control of neglected tropical diseases in the last 10, 15 years. What do you think can be done to make other members of the G7 and the G20 step up to the plate and contribute a bit more and match the sort of funding and proportionately that's coming from the US and the UK?
I think generically speaking, the biggest obstacle is for many people who look on foreign assistance or aid as kind of taxing poor people in rich countries to give money to poor people in poor countries without effectiveness. And so the main message that I can vouch to be accurate is that it is cost effective. Just to eliminate the blight of guinea worm or polio on one person is, you know, it's a matter that you can't quantify. It's worth more than you can estimate. But it cost us about £3 total. That's from private contributions from Arab countries and many others, including Great Britain, to do away with guinea worm. And that makes a profoundly important economic advantage to the world. There was one very small area, just one county in Nigeria that was analyzed by the World Bank on guinea worm. And they found that cost that region about $20 million, as a matter of fact, and not pounds, per year in lost agricultural product because the farmers with guinea worm couldn't get into the field. So it's a great economic and social and personal benefit to the people who receive it. So I think the main thing is to show that foreign assistance is needed from a humanitarian point of view, which doesn't make much impact on people that are spending the money, but also that it's very cost effective. It helps our country to do away with guinea worm in foreign countries. And it helps our country to do away with polio in foreign countries. It helped our country to do away with smallpox in other countries that had it. I think that's the best generic approach. And to publicize what is being done, I think the publicity that we get from this relatively unknown disease of dracoon colitis, just because I've been president and I've been involved in it, does help to lower the goal, to make it goal easier to raise some funds. We get a good bit of money from Arab countries. And so, but I go to these countries and I tell them quite often that my first priority from them is to help guinea worm. And they don't know what guinea worm is. And I tell them, well, I explain it to them and tell them that, you know, why don't you help us in countries that have a lot of Muslims there. And I said the same thing to the king of Saudi Arabia. He said, well, don't you want to help Christians too? And I said, yes, sir. And so on that visit, he gave me $9 million for guinea worm. So you have to use all kind of persuasive facts. But I think if you tell even children about guinea worm and how much it costs per guinea worm and get the children to raise maybe $10 each person, you know, the children will respond even, and of course the adults will. So I don't know how to answer your question directly. It's an almost insoluble problem. But it's been a wonderful chance for us to raise a lot of money. We never dreamed at the beginning it would cost $225 million to get rid of guinea worm. And now with just 22 cases left, we still need a lot of money because we have to keep 10,000 people employed in monitoring villages where guinea worm might break out. And we have to provide filter cloths and everything for them. So the cost is great, but that's always a challenge, raising money.
We're going to take a few more questions, but can I just, we have one from Twitter, from Dave, labouring in the UK. Will the eradication of guinea worm be your greatest professional achievement outside of your presidency?
Outside of my presidency. Well, it'll be the one that's most gratifying to me. You know, it's really heartwarming to go into a village that has had this affliction for thousands of years. And the only treatment they've ever had was to wrap it around a stick so that they would suffer 20 days instead of 30 days and not know what causes it. When we went to this first village, the chief told us that it was caused by eating the wrong species of goat, or that it was a curse put on them by the confluence of planets, or things that, like that. And to tell them it comes out of their pond was a sacrilegious thing for us to do, because the pond was considered sacred. If the pond hadn't been there, their ancestors wouldn't have lived there, their village wouldn't even exist. So we had to get a magnifying glass and showed them the little water fleas and said, look, this is what's in your pond, in your precious sacred pond. This is, it's evil spirits in your pond. Help us get rid of the evil spirits and make your pond, you know, sacred again. So we've had to use arguments like that. And I've mentioned the problem with the cartoons. So just to get to the basic, it was very, very important. But to help the people and see them actually be afflicted with over half the population being having guinea worms coming out of their body 1 year, including many school children, and then go back a year later, zero guinea worm. You can't imagine the warm feeling that I get. So I think that'll be my most cherished success. By the way, one of the signs that's been my favorite of all time, I was in Nigeria riding with in a big motorcade with the president's wife to a little village that had guinea worm. And school children had been turned out. They didn't have to go to school that day because I was visiting the country. And one group of children had a sign on their side that said, watch out, guinea worm, here comes Jimmy Carter. So, so that's still my favorite sign.
We have Naren Patel, Matt Ridley, Hugh Edwards, did you? And Hugh Edwards, please.
Okay, fine. Yes, sir.
Could you use the microphone?
Yeah, that'd be good. That'd be helpful for me.
President Carter, my name is Naren Patel. I'm a member of House of Lords.
Yes.
I'm full of admiration of what you've achieved. I was born in Africa. I visit there often, and I've seen what a terrible condition this is for people who are afflicted. You've achieved this by inflicting behavior change in the people, yes, teaching them what the problem is, and then behavior change. You alluded to river blindness.
Yes.
And obviously, that's the next one that could respond to the same kind of strategy. And I hope that you will progress to do that after you eradicated your last guinea worm.
Yes.
You expressed a wish that you will live to see the last guinea worm. I hope you change that wish to making sure the last river blindness is also right, achieved.
I'll change my priorities depending on, you know, what's decided by God. I'm praying that I'll survive the guinea worm. I'll also start praying. I promise you that I'll then start praying to see the last river blindness.
Thank you for today and for your efforts.
Thank you very much.
Mr. President, I'm delighted to hear, Matt Ridley, House of Lords, I'm delighted to hear you put the emphasis on eradication, in some contrast to the WHO, as you say.
Yeah.
And unlike smallpox, we can't keep guinea worm alive in the lab, so when it's gone, it's gone.
That's right.
For those who have, some people have qualms about this and say we should worry about the fact that we are for the first time deliberately extinguishing a species of animal. What do you say to such people?
I don't really respond to people like that. Unless they, if they've had guinea worm, I might sympathize with them, but I don't think anybody that's ever had guinea worm or seen guinea worm would make a statement of that kind. And I think mosquitoes will be a target in the future because lymphatic filariasis and malaria both are two diseases that can be eradicated from the world. They both depend on mosquitoes. As I mentioned earlier, I think, in Africa, it's the same mosquito. They're two different mosquitoes in our hemisphere. And of course, the new virus that's causing the deformed babies is also caused by mosquitoes. So I think in the long term, there might be an international effort to get rid of mosquitoes as well. That has not been done yet. The biggest, maybe one of the biggest advances made in medical technology in the last 20 years was the development of the of the insecticide-treated bed nets. Instead of just keeping the mosquito away from a sleeping person, it actually kills a mosquito when they land on the net. And we've now put two bed nets, for instance, in every home in Ethiopia that has mosquitoes at that altitude. So, we're now doing the same thing in Nigeria. And so that helps us with malaria and also with lymphatic filariasis. So that's a kind of generic approach that we don't yet know how to do, but in the future might happen. But I won't be particularly grieved when the last mosquito is gone. I'm trying to put guinea worm in other company, you know, to put it in perspective. Yes.
Your emergence onto the political scene 40 years ago now, in January of 76. And your candidacy then was characterized by energy, but above all, by optimism. You were unrelentingly optimistic about what was possible. And I'm just wondering now, four decades later, when we look around at the state of the world today and all the challenges that we face, are you still overwhelmingly an optimist? And if you are, why would that be?
Well, I think you have to be an optimist in order to persevere in the face of setbacks or disappointments or failures. And as I said a little bit earlier, I don't know if you noticed or not, that a failure to try is the only loss. If we don't try to achieve an apparently insurmountable obstacle, then we failed to start with. So I am basically an optimist. I think the millennium goals that have been set, And now we're in the process of revising those, I think we've made fairly good, substantial progress in many of them. The incidence of some diseases has gone down fairly dramatically, and the level of poverty on an average has gone down, although the disparity between rich and poor is still present and is concerning. But I think we're making progress. I can't say that individual countries have persisted in making progress toward democracy and freedom. But there's some changes that have been made. I've been disappointed with, for instance, the so-called Arab Spring, which started out so gloriously in Tunisia. And the Carter Center monitored the election in Tunisia, and that's been a success. But in Egypt and other places, it's been a setback. That's been a disappointment to me. One of the biggest personal disappointments in my international life has been the failure of us to bring peace to Israel and its neighbors. And one of the most grievous disappointments I've had in the last few years has been the withdrawal, even publicly stated by the president, that the United States might help bring progress toward peace between Israel and the Palestinians. And my hope is that the European Union and all of its members, including Great Britain, will step in and take the leadership in being aggressive in trying to bring about the general solution on which almost all of the governments in the world agree, except for Israel, of course. That is a two-state solution. So that's the kind of thing that I think have been successes made and setbacks made. When I completed the Camp David Accords, and part of that was to have peace between Israel and Egypt, that's been a permanent agreement. But the other half of it, the part on which we worked mostly, was to give full autonomy or freedom or independence or justice to the Palestinians. That part has not been done, so that's been a setback for me. But I think in general the world is moving toward more accommodation, primarily because of the communication capability now with immediate knowledge of every community about what goes on in the rest of the world. I think that is a basis on which we are inevitably going to make progress on political matters. Thank you.
I think it's good to end on a question about optimism. I think we are coming to the end of our session. We are going to have a drink, a reception, perhaps we should say, in the Royal Gallery in a minute. But I've got many, many people that I really want to thank, if I may. Thank you all for coming. It's really great to see this one room full and indeed used for such a beneficial purposes, if I might say. Can I thank Lord Chichi for initially this idea, and most of all for Kate Chichi, who's been organizing this. Can I thank the doorkeepers for all that they've done, and in particular also my private office, who've been absolutely wonderful, as they always always are.
Thank you for your good questions.
Thank you for your good questions. But above all, and indeed, perhaps I should mention that such has been the popularity of this that we have actually got an overflow room up in the river room, and they're all up there, and they're about to troop down and come and join us, are they not? Okay. So they've been watching this lecture on a live feed. But above all, I would like to thank, on behalf of all of you here, and indeed those in the River Room, you, President Carter, for coming and for giving us such an illuminating lecture and for telling us more about you. Thank you.